'cause I'd seen them crucify him, and I saw him die. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I'd promised him just added to my shame. 'Cause when at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. And even if he was alive, he wouldn't be the same. But suddenly the air was filled with strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide, and I fell down on my knees and just clung to him and cried. He raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt in my confusion disappeared in sweet release, and every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace.
Well, thanks again for joining us this evening. We're continuing to unpack some of the themes which I think really present themselves at this very special and lovely time of the year as we approach Easter. In our first session, we thought about the use of lament in Scripture and the way that that really connected both with Lent, the experience of going through Lent, but of course, perhaps something of where we've been over this last year. There has been that sense that there has been a lot to lament about in recent times. And then secondly, as we were preparing more to move into the Easter story, we thought about the whole theme of abandonment in terms of the cross. And it gave us the opportunity to think again about the experience of Jesus on the cross when he cries out, "My Lord, my Lord, why have you forsaken me?" And what exactly was Jesus experiencing at that moment? So I guess that gave us a lot to think about, and I hope you've had a chance to work your way through some of that. Tonight, I really want to focus on the declaration of the first disciples concerning the resurrection. And that, of course, was their declaration that Jesus had come back to life in a body. So the resurrection was a bodily experience for Jesus. And even though I guess we haven't quite entered into those latter moments of the Easter period, we haven't quite got to the cross and resurrection, nonetheless, of course, the cross and the resurrection, of course, for all time, every day, we need to meditate and think on the essence of what Christian faith is truly all about. So we're really going to ask that question tonight. Why was it important, and why is it important, to believe that Jesus rose in a bodily, that there was a bodily resurrection? Before we go in to think about that, I just wanted to read from Luke chapter 24, and just some verses beginning at verse 36. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood amongst them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking that they had seen a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do you doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they were still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Of course, there's many different views and many different opinions about the very nature of resurrection, the resurrection of Jesus. For those who argue that we live very much in a closed universe where the laws of science always apply, there can be no altering of the natural laws of science. Well, for them, of course, the resurrection is an impossibility. It just doesn't happen. Dead people do not rise to life again. On that basis, what they would probably argue is that the disciples experienced something, but not a literal historical resurrection. It was almost as if this was some kind of wished for fulfillment, a moment when they all that they had hoped for became a reality for them in that sense. Some sociologists suggest that the disciples suffered from something known as cognitive dissonance. Cognitive dissonance, quite simply, is when you begin to believe with all your heart and mind and spirit and soul in something that's happened, which in fact historically hasn't happened, but as far as you're concerned, in your mind, you genuinely believe it's taken place. Well, of course, that's an argument. It's a particular view that has been expressed by some concerning the resurrection stories. And just going back to that whole concept is the idea that even though the person who believes these things to be true, even when they're not true, even though you provide them with evidence to show that these things couldn't possibly have taken place, it actually doesn't call them to disbelieve in the event. It actually strengthens their belief. So it deepens their belief in something that they believe with all their hearts and minds and souls actually happened. Historically and in a literal sense, it didn't. But nothing is going to persuade them otherwise. Well, I guess we may have seen some of that in politics over these last few years. A belief in things that aren't true, and a strong belief, and no one can persuade you that in fact what they believe is not simply true. But as far as the disciples were concerned, I think this argument doesn't really hold weight, for the simple reason is that the disciples didn't think Jesus would rise from the dead. They didn't expect it to happen. This wasn't some sort of wished for outcome. It wouldn't have entered their minds to even consider the fact that someone could rise from the dead, let alone Jesus. Jesus was dead as far as the disciples were concerned. No one expected him to come back to life again. And that's because throughout Jewish scripture, there is no mention of a Messiah who comes back to life. It's not referred to at all. So in that sense, the disciples had no background that would have prepared them to believe that such a thing was possible. Alongside that, of course, the very notion that the Messiah should die on a cross, should be crucified, for the disciples, and of course for the Jewish people, the culture, and their understanding, their worldview at that time, of course, meant that the Messiah was a failed Messiah. Over the preceding years, up to the moment when Jesus dies on the cross, and following on from that event, there were many so-called messiahs who came along and taught that they were the Messiah. But ultimately, of course, they died, and that was it. Their mission had failed. So in that sense, there was no scriptural or historical basis on which the disciples might have an inkling that Jesus should rise from the dead. As far as they were concerned, when Jesus died on the cross, the game was up. Now, within Roman and Greek literature at that time, there were many stories, of course, about gods who died and came back to life. But there's certainly nothing comparable with that in Jewish scriptures. And of course, the Greco-Romans had all sorts of different understandings about how and when, following death, the return to life took place. There were those followers of Homer who believed, kind of unwillingly, that there might be a possibility that after death we might get a new body. Followers of Plato believed that the body was of no great value anyway, and that it was only the spirit that mattered. So the idea of us passing from this life into the next as a spirit was welcome to them, because it was the spirit that had value. So although there were much or different views on the whole concept of resurrection at that time, how life after death might look, the way that the disciples explain their experience of the risen Christ is very unique. It's not found in Jewish literature, it's not found in Jewish scripture, it's not found in Greek or Roman literature either, in any way that could be compared with what the disciples actually believed. This is very different, and this is very unique. There may have been some understanding that on the other side of the divide between this life and the next, people might receive a body. But what, of course, is different here is that Jesus' bodily resurrection takes place our side of the divide. Jesus dies and comes back to life in a body in our world, this side of the great divide between where we are today and where we go to be when we die. So this is unique. It's not ordinary. It's not something that the disciples could have anticipated or expected. This is radical. This is cutting edge. No one has experienced or seen or told of anything quite like this before. Of course, there are those who argue that the resurrection was simply a visionary experience. The argument very much is based around the kind of experience that Paul had, maybe on the road to Damascus, where he sees the risen Christ in that sense. But of course, again, the disciples here are not talking about a visionary experience of Jesus coming back to life. This is different. This is about a bodily resurrection. This is about somebody that you can touch, someone who can eat, somebody who has flesh and blood in a literal sense. This is not some kind of mystical experience. While those who argue that this was a mystical experience, of course, are just playing on that idea that very often, following the loss of somebody that you love, you might experience unusual occurrences of seeing them or feeling them or experiencing them at some kind of level. And of course, in one sense, that would have been a rational explanation for what the disciples were experienced themselves. And in one sense, it would have been to the advantage of the disciples to have declared that's how it was. In that sense, it would have been much easier for people to understand and to relate to. If the disciples, in their four accounts of the resurrection, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, had simply said, well, we had a vision of Jesus and had made no claim concerning a bodily resurrection, then in one sense, their message would have been a lot easier to convey to others and perhaps more convincing in that sense. If someone says to us, for example, I've seen God, well, I guess most of us would be thinking, well, that's great. But the assumption would be, of course, that they've had some sort of visionary experience of God, some kind of mystical experience of God. We wouldn't really expect them to say to us, yeah, God came. He came into my front room and he sat on my sofa. And whilst he was sat there, I made him a cup of coffee. And unfortunately, he got a bit excited and he knocked the coffee over. Well, I don't think many of us would imagine that the person saying, I've seen God, is actually saying that. And that's the thing. The disciples are actually saying that. They're saying that Jesus, following his death on the cross, not just appeared to them in a vision or some kind of mystical experience, but entered into the room where they were, came and sat amongst them, sat down and ate in front of them, declared himself to be flesh and bones. And of course, that's what makes the bodily resurrection of Jesus so important and so unique. If the disciples had declared it was a vision, more people probably would have accepted it. The fact that they all systematically declared it to be a bodily resurrection shows that they weren't just presenting something to win people over, to win more people over, to convince them. But what they were actually doing was telling people exactly what they saw and what they experienced, that Jesus had come alive again, but in a body. Why would you try and convince people of something that's much more difficult for them to understand when you can make it so much easier for them to grasp? It's a vision. It's a mystical experience. Well, people would have understood that. But of course, the disciples take a different route. And the argument, of course, is that they're telling the story as it was, as they experienced it, and not just to make it simply more convincing or easier for someone to understand. What is significant about the body? Jesus says himself, doesn't he? He says, I'm flesh and blood. I'm literally here. I'm not a ghost. I'm a real person in every sense. Why is that so important? Well, of course, within Greek philosophy at that time, it was the human spirit that mattered. The human spirit far outweighed the value of flesh and blood. The flesh had very little significance. It, of course, was in a whole process of decaying over time. And ultimately, when death came, of course, the decaying process was speed it up in that sense. So as far as the Greek philosophers were concerned, it was only the spirit that mattered. The flesh, well, you could do whatever you wanted with it. You could behave however you wanted. You could abuse it in whatever way, or abuse the flesh of others as long as the spirit remained. Because, of course, it was the spirit that mattered. The story of the resurrection, the bodily resurrection of Jesus, turns that on its head. Because it's what it's actually saying here is that the body matters, that flesh matters to God, that flesh has a part to play in how we understand and see the divine. And this is a radical statement. It's a radical statement within Jewish culture and literature and understandings and worldview. It was certainly a radical statement in terms of the Greco-Roman philosophers and how they saw the human body and related it as being virtually worthless. What the disciples were doing was declaring something that was way beyond their experience and way beyond their understanding. If we find the four stories of the resurrection of Jesus a little bit confusing, one person just putting a little emphasis here or another person putting a little bit more emphasis there, you can understand that. This was outside of their worldview. This was outside of their world experience. This was something very radical and very new for them, and they were trying to grasp what all of this meant. And of course, this plays into our understanding of the material, the everyday, the flesh and blood that our world is made up of through human life, and beyond that, into the world of nature. It challenges the view that at the end of time, God is about to destroy all that he's made. Instead, it reminds us that God values the material. He values flesh. He values the very substance of his creation. And he's not about to destroy it. He will transform it, as we see with the body of Jesus. It is a transformed body. And one day our bodies will be transformed. But it powerfully reminds us that God values flesh, what makes us, we're embodied and contained within in that sense. God will transform his creation, but he won't destroy it. He will bring it over into the age which is yet to come. The very word resurrection implies that somebody has died and risen to new life bodily in the same world. And that's what the word resurrection means, what it would have meant to the disciples at the time, what it would have meant both within Jewish and Greek and Roman culture. If somebody said, a resurrection has taken place, that's how people would have viewed it. They would have seen it as a claim that someone has died and come back to life in this life, this side of the great divide. It didn't imply some form of resuscitation. It didn't imply that the person has survived some terrible torture. It didn't imply that somebody had gone on to some kind of spiritual manifestation, some kind of ghost-like characteristics. Resurrection meant that you were alive, bodily alive, in this world, this side of the great divide. And so when the disciples declared the resurrection, everyone would have understood what they were saying. They were saying what they wanted to say deliberately because that's what they had experienced, that Jesus had come back to life. The resurrection had taken place. His body had come to be with them and brought Jesus' spirit to them in a very deep and personal way. Luke wants to emphasize for us that no matter how we understand the resurrected body of Jesus, he may well have been able to enter into a room that has a locked door. What he wants to emphasize to us is that Jesus is not a ghost. He may appear and he may disappear from their sight, but Jesus is real, more real than the disciples can fully grasp. Nothing like this had happened before. Nothing had been seen or experienced or been written about quite like this. Ghosts, of course, are quite unnerving. They're quite scary. Jesus isn't scary. Ghosts have no substance. Jesus has substance. Jesus, in every sense, is a person that they could hold and embrace, that they could walk and talk with, that they could eat. He is, Luke claims, flesh and blood. But he's more than that in these moments. He's so much more. He can't be contained. He can't be restricted. He can't be resisted, unless, of course, he chooses to be. He loves to embrace. And when people respond by seeking to embrace him, well, they don't fall through his body as if he's not really there. He is solid, Luke wants us to understand, more solid than we could ever imagine. He's not less human. He is now perfected human, perfected humanity. He's not less divine. He is still God in all his fullness. And when we see him, we will one day be like him. Not divine, not in our natures, divine like God, but in our perfected humanity. We will have bodies, but those bodies will be perfect, perfect bodies. They will be flesh and blood, but this would be a perfected humanity, perfected flesh and blood in that sense. And the lovely thing I find about the ascension story is that when Jesus ascends back to the Father, he's not like some sort of space rocket that jettisons his humanity. He leaves his humanity behind. He takes his perfected humanity into the Godhead with him. What a wonderful moment that is. Because, of course, if we go right back to the stories of Genesis, we find that out of the Godhead comes human life. It's perfect human life. And now in Jesus, perfected humanity has returned to be within the Godhead. And alongside that, one day, when we go to be with Jesus, we will be perfect, perfect in our humanity. And our perfection will, of course, be surrounded and embraced and welcomed and enjoyed within the Godhead of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Is it any wonder that the disciples struggled to explain this experience of the resurrection? They were trying to explain something under the guidance and the anointing of God's Holy Spirit that is the most significant and transforming moment in the history of this world. One day, we will be like him, Scripture says. A day that we can look forward to. a day when we too will be perfected in our humanity. What a day that will be when we see Jesus, the risen, ascended Lord, face to face. And that's the point. We will see him face to face, not as a ghost, not as some kind of apparition, not as some kind of vision, but face to face, in a body, Jesus, the Savior of the world.
Suddenly the air was filled with strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide. And I fell down on my knees and just clung to him and cried. He raised me to my feet. As I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt in my confusion disappeared in sweet release, and every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace.